All right, everyone, look at the screen. I am recording today, so anything stupid can and will be held against you on the internet forever. Sound good? I hear a phone ringing. Anyone else hear that? Am I going bonkers? I'm going bonkers. You knew it when we drove together, though. You're like, this dude's crazy. Okay, tell your lab partner what it says in red right up there. I love tests. I don't know about you guys, but I love them. Because I don't have to do anything besides watch you guys try and cheat. Anyone afraid of mice? Okay, good. All right, moving on. Don't worry about it. All right, we good? Oh, Emba, this is for you. Nice catch. Is that what you were stressed about? Okay, good luck. Page 10, I believe we filled in a giant table and then the bell rang right at the wrong moment. All right, you need your periodic tables out and page 10. I think we might get way far in this hour. I'm excited. So, what we are going to do, we are going to use the data from this page 10 to fill in this key of information for each bond type. So stick with me for the next couple minutes because this is important. So on the top right of your periodic table in bold, it says ionic bond, right? And then underneath that in bold, it says solubility, which means the ability of the thing to dissolve. So looking at your data table, did the things that were ionic dissolve? Yes, but only in what? Water. So on your periodic table for solubility, you are going to write dissolves in water, or just the word water is fine. But then I also want you to put a slash and then write the word polar, because they will dissolve in any polar liquid. Water is just the most common one that we use. All right? Conductivity then. Conductivity means does it conduct? So the ionic things, did they conduct ever? Yes. When? In solution. So on conductivity, write in solution only. You're going to want that exactly that way so you don't get some of the questions wrong. All right, then malleable. Were they malleable or brittle? They're brittle. All right, then their MP and BP means their melting point and their boiling point, and it's either going to be high, medium, or low. So which one do you think those are? They are the highs. You see what we're doing? Will you try and do it for the next three? If there's any doubt in your mind and you only have a pen, don't write it down. In the next, 4 minutes from now, we'll go over it together to make sure we have it perfect. Good? Silence means yes. So, let's see, do I have it on here somewhere? Oh boy, I don't think I do. It's on the other one. Okay, hold on. So here we go. Double check your work here. So for ionic, it's water / polar, only in solution, brittle and high. For polar, it's also water / polar. They do not conduct, so none. They are brittle, and they have a medium melting point and boiling point. Then nonpolar, that says hexane / NP. That means hexane or nonpolar substances. Thank you. He's not here. Does that matter? All right, and then they don't conduct, they're brittle, they have the lowest. And then your metals. They don't dissolve, but they do conduct in pure form. They are malleable and have high melting and boiling point. All right, thumbs up if you're ready to go on. Sweet. That's the bottom ones. This is way cute. How did you even do that? Is it a sticker? You what? It's impressive. Yeah. I could never be so delicate. Did you have it on both hands? Skills these girls have, Frank. Who would know? Okay, now let's apply this. This is the most important thing to you for the rest of the test. Not the rest of the test, whatever, the test. So you have to be able to do the following. There's 30-ish questions like this. So the first thing it will say is, what type of bonds are there in Al2O3? So the first thing you need to do is determine the bond type. Raise your hands if you know how to do that by now. That's most of you. So to determine the bond type, we have two options. We can do the math, 1.5 and 3.5. What's the difference between these two? 2. And that means this is an ionic bond. Or if you knew aluminum was a metal and the other one was a non-metal, you would also know it's ionic. Good so far? All right, then the test will just ask these questions. It's super simple. It will say, does it dissolve in water, hexane, both, or neither? And you would say, water. It would say, does it conduct in pure form? And you would say, no. It only conducts when? In solution. It will ask if it has a high, medium, or low melting and boiling point. You would say, high. And then brittle or malleable, you would say brittle. Not hard. Let's prove it. So we, I actually probably didn't want to do that, whatever. Will you try this? Don't write these answers on your periodic table. Write them like on the cover or on the side of some page in your lab book, but not on your periodic table. So take about 2 minutes and try and come up with the answers to this. Okay, so first thing first, Ca2O is what type of bond? Thank you. It is ionic. Well, that's ironic. We just did one like that. Will it conduct in pure form? No. In solution? Yes. Almost put a no on accident. Does it dissolve in water or hexane? This is not a yes or no question. I know it's written that way, but on the test, it will say water, hexane, both, or neither. FYI, both and neither is never the right answer. It's just an extra way for me to try and confuse you. Is it brittle or malleable? Brittle. Will it melt at a high or low temperature? Well, hello. You're right. High is the correct answer. Easy enough? Okay, I have one more. There you go. Try that. P2O5. Your difference here is 1.4, which means it is polar. All right, will it conduct in pure form? No, it never conducts, so both of those are no's, correct? Water or hexane? Water. Is it brittle or malleable? Is it solid? Brittle, thank you, and it melts at a medium. Sorry, that wasn't an option, but it was medium. So who did fine on that? Okay, so we good? Okay, turn to page 16. Page 16 has a giant table that will be very simple now that you have all the information you need to answer that. We'll give you 3 minutes, and once you start playing on your phones, then I know you're done. All right, on page 11, well, that's a little bit different, but that's okay. Ignore that. We're recording today. But on page 11, we're going to do this lab. And about 5 years ago, the state updated what they call the banned substance list. And they won't let me have cobalt anymore. So we just recorded this, made this short little demo, and we can do what we need to do. So here we go. In this lab, you will experimentally determine the correct formula for cobalt hydroxide by combining cobalt and hydroxide, strange, and observing which one combines to create the most precipitate. This is a new word to you. A precipitate is when two liquids react to form an insoluble product, or, as I call it, sinkies. If we know what floaties are, right? They're sinkies because eventually they go to the bottom. All right, you'll answer the questions on page 11 of your Bonded for Life lab book. You will also want to have your naming schemata handy. Ooh, you've been holding on to that forever. If you don't have a naming schemata, come get one from me. They look like this. They're giant. All right, good. All right, I consider the front page to be the page that says common polyatomic ions. So will you all take it out? Turn to the side that says common polyatomic ions. And we'll go from there. What you will use this for today is we're going to start doing like the drop and swap, but we're going to do it with things that aren't just an atom. We're going to do them for things that are combined atoms, and we call those polyatomic ions. You good so far? So first we're going to talk about hydroxide, which is probably about where my finger is. So will everyone find hydroxide? Wow, I am on it. Got lucky. It's right there. So hydroxide is OH, and it has a little dash by it. That dash is its charge. If there's not a number there, it means it's negative one. Are you okay with that? All right, so this is called hydroxide. It's a polyatomic ion. Okay, it's an ion, meaning it's charged, made out of more than one atom. Polyatomic ion. All right, and look, we know H wants to be H2O when it's with oxygen, right? But this is just OH, which would not work except it's accepted an electron from somewhere, and that completed the octet on oxygen. You okay? So it's a little weird. I'm sorry I put that box right in front of you. Are you as tired as you look? Prom hangover. All that Kool-Aid. All right. Anyway, polyatomic ions, we're going to use those today. Good? So elements or their ions combined in simple whole number ratios like H2O to form compounds. These ratios are not always 1-to-1. Some positive ions require more than one negative ion in order to form stable compounds, such is the case in the reaction of cobalt chloride with sodium hydroxide. So our job in this lab that we're going to watch the video of is to determine the correct ratio of drops that produces the most precipitate. That will tell me the formula. So here we go. Fill in the data table. I know it's page 11 now, but we'll work through it. If you look at the top row, it says well number, and it goes 1 through 7. You all right with that? Well, we're already done. The next row down says 0, and then at 2. And then what do you think the next number is? 4. And just keep going with by 2s up till 12. And then the row below that, you have 12, and then 10, and then 8, and then keep going down. And now the row below that, it says ratio of cobalt to hydroxide. So what we're going to do is we're going to take these fractions and turn them into ratios. So the first one says 0 to 12. The next one says 1 to 5. I've just reduced it. So the next one is 4 to 8, which isn't really 4 to 8. It's what? 1 to 2. What's 6 over 6? 1 to 1. 8 over 4 would be 2 to 1. 10 over 2 would be 5 to 1. And then 12 to 0. All right, so what we're going to do next, I'm going to hit play. Or whatever. I'm going to go to the next slide, and the video will play. And it's just me literally dropping drops in microwells. It's called the microwell strip, so it's a little different than it looks like usually. And we're just going to see which combination makes the most stuff. In the video, the microwell plate already has the clear liquid, which is the hydroxide, and I'm going to add the cobalt, which is the pink liquid. And when they react, they'll make a blue precipitate or a blue sinky. Was that as amazing for you as it was for me? Okay. Now, that's pretty blurry. So I let it sit for 5 minutes, and then I took a picture of it. And there is what happens 5 minutes later. These are the precipitates formed. They're all the same precipitate, but we're looking for the well that made the most. So what we're going to do now is... That's the wrong button. There we go. We're going to do that, which I just erased for some reason. So I know that the number 2, it goes up pretty high, but it's not all the way full like number 3 is. So in the next row down, you're just putting lines to roughly where the stuff is. Now, if you feel like scribbling or shading or whatever underneath it, do it. If you don't, don't. I couldn't care less. So weird listening to me in the other room. All right. Now, there are 3 questions. That looks good. I like the highlighting. There are 3 questions. Well, there's 4, I know, but there's 3 that you can now answer. And I want you to give it a good, hard, thoughtful try with your lab partner. Because if you can know the ratio will tell you the formula. If you can know the formula, then the formula can, in number 3, the formula can tell you the charge of cobalt if you think about it the right way. So why don't you try questions 1, 2, and 3 and see how that goes real quick. So based on this observation, which well number, this is question 1, which ratio essentially was best? That's cute. Apparently that doesn't work. 3, which meant, and I'm going to write it the long way, it meant that there was one cobalt, one cobalt to two, and what's the formula for hydroxide? To 2OH. That's the long answer to the first question. Okay, if you just wrote 1 to 2, that's fine. But I'm writing it the long way, so it will show you that that's the formula. So what's the formula? COOH2. Now, pretty much everybody every year gets this wrong, which is fine. It is CO and OH, and you do need two of them. How many of you wrote that? Raise your hands. Oh, my. You just said it, and you didn't write it? Going to pass out. Well, you're supposed to. How did you know that? Okay. Did anyone else put it in parentheses? First one this year, probably this decade, millennium, whatever. The correct answer is COOH2. Because exactly like Jeremy said, that's because that's what you do. Two sisters in AP Chem, right? You're destined to be good at chemistry. Yeah, you should have. So here we go. If we have COOH2, this means there's two H's, but only one O. But that's not what we need here, right? We need two OHs to every one CO. All right, now this is not going super hot, but we can still be friends, most of us. All right. Once we have this formula, the formula will tell me the charge of cobalt. Do you know where it's telling me? Okay. How many of you understood the drop and swap? Raise your hands. Okay. If you understand the drop and swap, then this isn't very hard. You know the number that's here goes down there, don't you? So wouldn't the number right here go up there? Proper use of it, double arrow there, so that doesn't count. So what's the charge of cobalt? It's a 2 or a positive 2. It's a positive 2, by the way, because cobalt is a metal, which really means cobalt is a loser. If you lose negative, what do you become? Positive. I feel like this is going super awesome. Let's try another one together. It's right on your paper. So the first thing on number 4, it says, what do you think you would have gotten if you had used the following pairs or something like that? So the first thing, we have silver and cyanide. So we're going to need to use our naming schemata. Silver is Ag, which you should have memorized. If you don't, the next two tests are going to be really hard for you. And then cyanide is a polyatomic ion, so where would you find that? On your naming schemata. Will everyone find it and touch it? You're going to die. Sorry. Funny to me. You don't care. Cyanide will kill you deader than dead, FYI, and you're all touching it. Okay. You guys, I quit. Okay. No, I'm not. Okay, we both suck. What's the formula of cyanide then? CN. AgCN. Now, we need to find out their charges. And I will show you something that's very nice. Okay, Hermes knows CN's a negative 1, and so should everyone else, because you're touching it, right? All right, now look. Look at me. Silver does not have a charge that you would know. So, if you turn this over, there's a box right here that says metals. That will tell you the charges of some of the metals. Is silver in that box? You bet it is. It's a plus 1. So, everybody, help me out here. If these numbers already add to 0, what numbers do you put down here? Nothing. Thank you, Hermes, for coming today. You don't do anything, right? Because they already add to 0. OK, Okay, let's pretend. So this is the answer, by the way. You do not have to put these in your answer, but if you do, it's fine. They are there to help you find the answer. But for just a second, let's pretend. If this was a plus 3, what would this look like? All right, good. AGCN 3. Because if we ever need more than one of more than one thing, that has to be in parentheses. Okay? Now, it wasn't. It was a 1. But the next ones will be different numbers. It's still silver. Oh, boy. How do you do a G? That's hard left-handed. All right? It's still silver, but I have a different polyatomic ion. Will you do your best on your own to find silver sulfate and what its formula would be? So what's the formula for sulfate? SO4. All right, now, silver is still a plus 1. Sulfate, though, is a what? Tell your lab partner, not me. Negative 2. Good answer. So now we need to drop and swap. So what would the formula of this be? Ag2SO4. Do I need to parenthesize this? No, because I only need one of it. So it's already there. Okay, try the next one on your own. If you don't know the charge of calcium, that's fine. You can find it right here. Frank P. put it right above calcium and its family. That's an A. All right, so CA is what charge? Plus 2. ASO4 is what charge? Negative 3, drop and swap, correct? So CA3, then parentheses, ASO, sorry, there was a 4 right there, I'm sorry, and then the 2, right? Sound good? Okay, let's do one more. So what if aluminum was to hang out with phosphate? Find me that formula, would you? So plus 3 minus 3, what do we do? Nothing. So it is just ALPO4. Who had that one right? Raise your hands. Okay, you guys are great. All right, we are pretty much, we're good there. Turn to page 12 and we'll just get a head start on what we're doing tomorrow. Tomorrow's lab, it's not a lab, it's more of an activity. The difference is we're not going to deal with chemicals that can hurt you, so we'll just call it an activity. It's called Sticks and Spheres. So page 13, sorry, not page 12. Oh, I said it wrong. It's Spheres and Sticks. Sorry if you were confused. And the reason we call it that is because you can't say balls in a high school. Kids can't handle it anymore. I don't really get it, but moving on. Here we go. So your procedure. What you're going to have is a bag, and in that bag, you're going to have a bunch of things that represent metals and nonmetals. They are sticks and spheres. So you'll have essentially like one of these. And this would be considered the stick because it has the stick. And this would be considered something that is plus one because it has one to give away. You okay with that? What we're looking for is something it could hang out with. And that would be something that would be a minus one. And then that would be what we would put together to make our models with. So the first thing I want you to do across the top of this table is put what Danielle already did, plus 1, plus 2, plus 3, and then down the side is a minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. All right, so let's make this a little bit harder because that's just boring. Let's say, so I have my data table. Let's do this one. So plus 2, minus 1, right? So we would have these spheres and sticks. A plus 2 would be a circle with two sticks. All right? And we're going to try and put this model together to make sure every stick goes somewhere and to make sure every sphere has a full hole. But we can only use spheres with one hole in them. So how many am I going to have to use over there? Two. Thanks, Myers. I'm going to have one right here and one right there. So go ahead and draw that shape because that's the structure we will build there. Then, looking at the directions in bold, so we label the columns. And we've made a model for that square. Number two, we drew it. Number three, label the circles that represent the sticks, plus one, plus two, or plus three. So I should have had a plus one right here. Sorry, plus two, minus one. So that's the next part. The next piece of instruction says, choose a representative element. So we need an element that would be a plus two. What column would you find something that's a plus 2 in? Family 2. What's your favorite family 2 element? What? Calcium. All right. So this represents calcium. And then what column do you find something that's a minus 1? 7, someone said. So what's your favorite family 7? Fluorine. Good answer, because that's one letter. So now we label like that. The next step probably says to write the formula then. So the formula of this would be how many CAs? One. And how many Fs? Two. CAF2. The last thing it tells you to do is to name it. All of these will be easy. I won't be able to fit it in that box, but this is called calcium. Fluoride. Calcium fluoride. We're going to do that for every box tomorrow. Sound easy? Hello, Hayden.